What's up, folks? I decided that today was the day and that we were going to get some notification from Judge Reed O'Connor's office. So I decided that I was going to, you know, confine myself to my office, do some stuff around here, and then continuously refresh FPC's page all day waiting for notifications so I could bring you guys the breaking news. And I decided about an hour and a half ago that I was going to go to the gym and take a break. And what you know, as soon as I get there, get spooled up and nice and hot and sweaty, as you can still see, that the notification came down. So basically what that means is that we just have to subvert Curtis's physical fitness every day and we're going to get good news, right? So what I'm bringing you today is an absolute smackdown by this judge on the government and the ATF. It is fantastic, but I actually think that besides the mostly positive nature of this ruling, that there's actually a trap in here that I'm going to walk through with you guys, and I want to know what your guys' thoughts are. That said, I recently got a talking to from my YouTube rep. If you guys could take a few seconds out and check your subscription notification settings, make sure that they're set up the way that you want them to be, because I know they've been changed around without your knowledge. Only 13% of you are currently subscribed with all notifications on. If you can go over there and change that around, it drastically will help the health of my channel and allow us to get this notification out to more and more people that the Second Amendment is winning and winning big. But before we get into this, capitalism break. Be back in a few seconds. Kentucky Anti Gun Works is best known for their research and development into lubrication technology. They use their enhanced reliability oil on a daily basis, but they've started to move into some other stuff, like, for instance, they recently came out with their slings, equipped with a fast adjust that allows you to get out of it really quickly. And they've also recently released their minimalist quick-released sling retainers. KGW offers VSO subscribers a discount, and you can find that information over at the affiliates page. Special thanks to them for making today's video possible. So I'm not going to walk you through the entire lineage of this case because at this point in time, that would take an entire video by itself. So there, go watch those other videos that I made on the topic if you need to get caught up. But most recently, it was at the circuit court, and they sent it back down to the district court to Reed O'Connor's office. And that's a whole concept of the district court being closest to the plaintiffs, therefore having the most information about the case, and therefore will be the best to establish the remedies, so to speak. So they sent it back down and they said, hey, this is clearly violating the APA and more and most likely the Second Amendment as well, but we're sending it back down to Reed O'Connor to rule on the merits of the Administrative Procedures Act, and we're not going to place any limits on what else he has to say in the case. And that's where we pick up today. Going to the conclusion, the court holds that each plaintiff has demonstrated entitlement to preliminary injunctive relief against the government's defendants' enforcement of the final rule that the United States Court of Appeals, Fifth Circuit, determined to be invalid under the Administrative Procedures Act. Accordingly, the court orders that the government defendants are hereby, one, enjoined from implementing and enforcing against the Firearms Policy Coalition and all of its members the provisions of the law determined to be unlawful. Two, enjoined from implementing and enforcing against Maxim Defense and all of its customers. Three, enjoined from enforcing against Mock and his family. Four, enjoined from implementing against Lewis and his family. It then goes on to say that this doesn't count for anybody who is already prohibited from possessing firearms under 18 U.S.C. 922G. Injunctive relief shall take effect immediately and remain in effect pending the conclusion and final disposition of all claims before the court. Translation, if you're any of those plaintiffs, pistol brace rule does not apply to you. However, just above the conclusion, the court declines plaintiffs' invitation to extend the scope of injunctive relief nationwide. Injunctive relief reflecting that previously afforded by the Fifth Circuit to plaintiffs is sufficiently limited to not provide relief beyond the parties in this case. Basically, we kind of knew that this was going to happen, okay? If you looked at any of the posts I made last week, circuit courts and district courts are very hesitant when it comes to their preliminary injunctions expanding the scope outside the parties of the case, because if they overburden the defendants by expanding the scope, then there is concern that they are more ripe for dispute down the line than if they limited it to the parties who actually brought the suit. And like I said, this was pretty much expected, and I know this is not what we want to hear, but what I have to show you now is something that Reed O'Connor did that he did not necessarily have to do. He went outside of the APA arguments and went hard in the Second Amendment. Now, I'm not going to read all 38 pages of this for you. You should read this. It's fantastic. But a few areas that he hits on: impairment of a fundamental right, weapon in common use, presumptively protected conduct, threat of impairment. He even went as far as to berate the government on how unpopular this was by showing that only 8% of everyone affected by this, using the most conservative numbers, complied with the regulation. But the part that I really want to highlight for you guys is as follows. The Supreme Court has already established that the text, history, and tradition of the Second Amendment's operative clause, the right of the people to keep and bear arms, protects an individual's right to possess, carry, and operate commonly used handguns in the home and in public for lawful purpose of imminent self-defense. As such, the Second Amendment presumptively guarantees plaintiffs to keep and bear braced and unbraced pistol arms at home and in public for general self-defense use. The Second Amendment also presumptively protects the FPC's members' proposed course of conduct insofar as it involves making common safety-improving modifications to otherwise lawfully bearable arms for the purpose of ensuring the performance of self-defense. The conduct of acquiring, attaching, and maintaining rearward attachments such as a stabilizing brace serves to make the pistol stable and thus the user more accurate. The successful performance of armed self-defense entails not only deterring or neutralizing life-threatening perpetrators, but also preserving innocent life and preventing bodily injury to others as much as possible. Users directly advance these fundamental ends of self-defense when they modify lawfully bearable pistols with rearward attachments, whether as a brace or a stock. And then goes on to talk about how this was totally a thing in the American Revolution, how Americans took pistols and put stocks on them and grips. Did you catch that? Because this says that it is presumptively protected conduct for you to modify your pistol, whether it's with a pistol brace or with a stock. If you are an NFA proponent, you should be quaking in your boots right now. Because the death nail is, you know when you tap a nail in before you really go to swing it? That's where that nail is right now. It is hovering over the NFA's heart. And this is the first argument that we have seen in an opinion by a judge in an active Second Amendment case that challenges the validity of the NFA. This is a trap for the ATF. The Fifth Circuit already said that they expect to see this court case back and that it may very well have Second Amendment concerns in it. So this just gave the FPC the legs that they need to challenge the NFA in this case. And I want to know what you guys have to say about that in the comment section down below. I cannot wait for this trap to be sprung.